With my team from the Brigham, we presented a first an overview of the use of psychopharmacology in patients with multiple sclerosis. And the reason why that is important is because the prevalence of psychiatric disorders is very high in MS. For any given psychiatric disorder, the prevalence is 2 to 3 times higher in patients with MS than in the general population. And while we do not think of psychopharmacological agents as the only answer to treat psychiatric symptoms, it's certainly one tool that we have, and it can be very helpful and improve patients' quality of life, coping with MS, adherence to the disease-modifying therapies, etc. The interesting point, one of the many interesting points, is that there are very, very few trials of antidepressants or the different types of agents, specifically for patients with multiple sclerosis. So when we are sitting with a patient with bipolar disorder, for instance, and MS, we tend to select the agents primarily using the same thinking algorithm that we would use for a general psychiatric patient. However, for each one of the groups of different agents, there are certain pearls or take-home messages that are specific to MS that clinicians should be aware of. So in our course, we first did like a general overview of psychopharmacology, and then we discussed what are those specific take-home messages. First and foremost, the most important take-home message is not to oversimplify. So not to think that because a patient with an individual with MS has depression, this is just a vanilla major depressive disorder and you just write a prescription for an SSRI. So is to take the time. If this takes more time or effort from the clinician, takes involvement of other team members, but to take some time to evaluate, there is sadness. Okay, moving from there, is there a major depressive episode? And then moving from there, what are the factors involved causing the depression? How much is the impact of pain from MS? How much is there is a comorbid sleep disorder which will affect the depressive symptoms? Did the depression start after starting the disease-modifying therapy or after starting steroids or after, so is there possibly an impact from medications contributing to depression? So that's number one, right? To do a thorough assessment. In terms of, once you decide, okay, yes, this person has major depression and would benefit, say, from an antidepressant, some of the take-home messages are even the most benign psychotropics in a patient with a neurological illness, their brain is more sensitive, so you want to be cautious when you prescribe and start generally with lower doses, right? Go up slower. You also want to consider the comorbidities. There is a high comorbidity of PMELS, periodic limb movement disorder of sleep, and as well as restless legs syndrome in MS. SSRIs, which are the most commonly prescribed antidepressants, can worsen restless leg syndromes, so you want to pay attention to that in patients with MS. Another lesser known side effect of antidepressant is that in the long term, if they are used for many years, they can contribute to bone fragility. In patients with MS who have risk for falls, that becomes more important than it would in the general population. So that's in the field of antidepressants, and there are some other tips in the field of antipsychotics I can share if they are of interest. Yeah, so the antipsychotics, classically, general psychiatry, this is psychiatry 101, they are divided in the conventional antipsychotics and the newer generation antipsychotics. Nowadays, clinicians are more likely to prescribe newer second-generation antipsychotics because generally they are more benign in terms of side effects and they are equally effective to the older agents. Specific points for MS include that the agents that have higher potency in antagonism of the dopaminergic 2 receptor are more likely to cause extrapyramidal side effects like Parkinsonism, problems with gait and with movement, tremors, etc. So in a patient with MS who already has gait problems, motor problems, you will typically want to avoid. Risperidone is one example, but in general, those agents with higher degree of D2 antagonism. Another thing that applies specifically to patients with MS, some of the agents are more sedating than others. So an example is quetiapine, which is can be very helpful at low doses for sleep and for agitation. But if you have a patient who is already psychomotorly retarded with severe fatigue, you will likely avoid quetiapine in that patient and prefer something that is more activating, and so on and so forth.